event of this event spectacular here at the Abu Dhabi Book Fair, we have somebody you may have heard of. He's a fantastic broadcaster. He's a superb journalist, and he does a thing called public speaking. Hands up if you would like to know what public speaking is. Right, it is quite simply speaking in public. More importantly, it is speaking to public. So public speaking is if you are the teacher, you're at the front of the class, talking to a class of students, that's public speaking. If you're a student called up to talk to your cohort, your classmates, that's public speaking. If you are the imam in the mosque, talking to the congregation, talking to the believers, then you are public speaking. If you are standing here in front of a microphone talking to you, you are public speaking. There are tricks to public speaking. There are rules to public speaking. Most people don't know them. Some people know them and get them wrong. The great thing about Richard is he is going to teach you what the rules are, and he is going to show you how to get them right. You could not be in safer hands. You are the privileged amongst the privileged because you are about to be given the keys to skills that will serve you all your life. Are you up for this? Come on, you do better than that. Make a big, really big noise. Are you up for this? Very good. Would you please give a huge, and I mean stamp your feet, clap your hands, and cheer as loudly as you can for Mr. Richard Dean!
Thank you very much indeed for that utterly undeserved introduction, but I'm delighted for it. Right, I'm going to start with a quiz. Somebody can win a copy of this book, and it's worth 100 dirhams, so you can put it on Dubizzle or something afterwards and spend it on something decent. It's a question, to be fair, that I should probably be putting to your parents, or maybe even grandparents, because it's about something that happened 50 years ago. But have a listen to this piece of music, and then there will be a question, and the first person who gets it right will win this book. When I get to the bottom, I go back to the top of the slide. We'll stop and a turn, and a go for a ride. Till I get to the bottom, and I see you again. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Head is scared up. Head is scared up. Head is scared up. Right. Who can name the band? The Beatles, well done, many congratulations. That's a copy of my book, Crowd Pleaser. It is The Beatles. That song was called Helter Skelter, and it's from an album. The album is called The Beatles, but it's known as the White Album because it is white. And here's the thing about the White Album. 50th anniversary was November last year. Just had its 50th anniversary. And it's full of some brilliant, classic Beatles songs like Helter Skelter and Dear Prudence and While My Guitar Gently Weeps. The other thing about the White Album is it's full of absolute rubbish. Some of the worst Beatles songs they ever recorded. Hey, Bungalow,
did you kill? Have you seen the bigger piggies in the starched white shirt?
Really, just some turgid, dreadful nonsense that even your parents, who were of that generation, wouldn't like. Ringo Starr was the drummer with the Beatles, and he said this: the White Album could and should have been one of the greatest rock and roll albums of all time. Not just best Beatles albums, rock and roll albums. He said, but it wasn't because when they made it into a double album, so double the length, they had to fill it up with lots of second-rate songs. Now, that's Ringo Starr, that's the Beatles. What's it got to do with public speaking? Well, this guy, again, who your parents would know, is a businessman called Jack Welch, and he used to run a company called General Electric that makes a lot of the engines that go on Etihad's planes, among other things. And he was regarded as the greatest businessman of the 20th century by Fortune magazine. And this is a book that his speechwriter, Bill Lane, wrote. with their lessons on public speaking, because Jack Welch was a famously good public speaking. That's how he motivated the thousands of people who worked for him. And they had something called the Ringo Rule, named after Ringo Starr. And just as Ringo Starr had said, they should have taken the White Album and cut it in half, thrown away the bad stuff, but kept the good stuff. Bill Lane and Jack Welch say you should do the same when you finish writing a speech or presentation. Chop it in half, get rid of the second-rate stuff, and just keep what's left. And they said that if you've got to write a speech or do a presentation, who here has to do presentations at school or outside of school? Yeah, most people do these days. My kids are 6 and 8. They had to do one on Spider-Man last week. Once you've finished, chop it in half, and it will almost always be made significantly better. And when you're doing your editing, don't like cut around the edges and trim little bits. You should edit it with a cleaver, bang. Just be ruthless when you're editing. Chop things away and get rid of them. Edit with a cleaver, not with a scalpel. So let's pause for a moment and breathe, because you should always breathe when you're doing public speaking. The point of my book, Crowd Pleaser, it is called The 100 Greatest Public Speaking Tips of All Time, from Socrates, the ancient Greek philosopher, to Steve Jobs, the guy who founded Apple. And it's 100 hints and hacks and pro tips to help you improve your talks. And the promise that I make that the book will help you transform your talks in minutes. Everyone's busy doing a bunch of stuff. You haven't got a load of time to invest in public speaking, but these hacks will help you transform your talks in minutes. And what I'd urge you to do is to follow some of these tips. Now, you can get a book like mine and read them. Loads of them are out there on the internet. Just Google 10 tips on public speaking. You'll get 100 lists. Most of it's perfectly good advice. Follow it. Follow the advice that you're given. And a lot of it's out there for free on the internet. And if you do that, you will give better presentations. You will produce them much quicker. And if you're teaching anyone to do public speaking, they're really, really useful as well. So today I am not going to share all 100 tips in Crowd Pleaser, because we would be here until midnight. And I know the Filipino school have got to leave at 12:30, so you're definitely not staying here till midnight. But what I am going to do is share 5 of them. 5 tips from Crowd Pleaser, very quickly, and you can take them away and use them next time you're giving a presentation. And this is the first one I'm going to share with you. Edit your presentation with a cleaver. It's the one I just shared from Jack Welch. Now, interestingly, the second part of this tip is to avoid radical paperball therapy. The second tip that General Electric had, this is a $400 billion company with 300,000 people. A lot of people had to give a lot of presentations. And what they did, if your presentation was boring, I shall demonstrate it now. Who's got a pad? Have you got pads? I think you were given some paper. Yeah? Can some of you take a piece of paper? Can you tear one out of your pad? Okay. If you've got a spare piece of paper, it doesn't matter if you haven't. I just need a few people to do it. People at the back, you're not exempt. Just because you're hiding at the back, if you've got a piece of paper, please tear it up. Okay, and then screw it up into a paper ball like this. This is radical paper ball therapy. I promise you, this is General Electric, $400 billion company. This is how they teach their staff to give presentations. Have we got some paper balls? Hold your paper balls in the air. Okay, can you come to the front down here if you've got a paper ball? Can you stand up and come to the front down here? Okay. Great, okay, all come close together. You don't all have to be here. If you've got a paper ball now, that's great. If not, you can stay seated. Okay. And on my count, what I want you to do is take those paper balls and throw them at me. 3, 2, 1. Thank you very much indeed. You can sit down now. Some of you are enjoying that a little bit too much. Now, what's the point of all this? The point is, radical paper ball therapy was what Jack Welch and Bill Lane used if someone was boring. If you were giving a presentation at GE and it was too long or it was too boring, they would screw up a piece of paper, literally, and throw it at you, and you knew your presentation was over. I'm not making it up. It's... It's in this book by Jack Welch and Bill Lane, Radical Paperball Therapy. It's a thing. So that is the number five in the list of tips that I'm going to share with you today. It takes about 10 minutes to edit your presentation with a cleaver. If you're doing it, do you use PowerPoint or Keynote or Prezi? Which one? Which one do you use? PowerPoint. Yeah, Keynote and any Apple users? There is one button you need on your laptop or your tablet. It's the delete button. It doesn't take long. Creating a presentation takes a long time. Delete does not. Okay, so number four. Number four is that you should swear. And your teachers are thinking, what is happening here? What have we brought these kids to? Let me explain. This guy here is a guy called Tony Robbins. He's a life coach and self-help guru from the United States. He is, by some considerable distance, the best paid public speaker in the world. He's coming to Dubai on September the 3rd. He's doing a one-day talk at the new Coca-Cola Arena in Dubai. The cheapest tickets cost 1,000 dirhams for one day. The VIP tickets cost 20,000 dirhams each. 20,000 dirhams for a day. The guy is a phenomenon. I was in London 2 weeks ago watching him. He did a four-day event in London. He earned, in US dollars for that weekend, $30 million. Okay? Whether you like him or not, he's a public speaking phenomenon. And one of the things about Tony Robbins is that he swears a lot on stage, and that can be shocking. But he doesn't do it gratuitously. And parents, don't worry, this is safe. Don't worry, this is all safe. He doesn't do it gratuitously. He does it for a reason.
Excuse me.
I read a book at 22 years old called Taboo Language, which changed my life. It was written by a brilliant psychiatrist who had studied Freud. And he said, you know, Freud was a genius and he was messed up. But his genius was that if you try to make a change and you don't succeed, it's because consciously you say you want one thing and unconsciously another. And so he would use provocative language.
So he would use provocative language for a reason. And he uses it because it breaks through barriers. Now, that's Tony Robbins. He's on stage. He's a big guy. He can do it. I can't swear on stage. My day job is a radio presenter with Dubai Eye Radio. I broadcast across the UAE every morning, 20 hours a week. Can I swear on radio in the UAE? Of course not. Absolutely not. I can't swear on a stage like this, and you can't swear when you're giving a presentation. However, there is a wider point here. And the wider point is when you're giving a presentation, be as conversational as you possibly can. Because the point about using what he called taboo language or informal language is that it breaks through barriers. Sometimes when we're giving a presentation, you can fall into the trap of thinking that you have to be very formal and use very big words and be terribly, terribly formal. And that's wrong. And there's been all kinds of studies done. This is from the Journal of Educational Psychology by a professor called Richard Mayer at the University of California that finds that casual, informal, conversational language is much more powerful and effective when trying to get your message across. So don't swear, okay? Let me be very clear. Don't swear when you're giving a presentation, but do take the lessons from Tony Robbins and apply them in a way that's appropriate culturally, as I do, and use conversational language where possible. It's just so much more effective. Probably going to take you 30 minutes to go through a speech or a presentation when you've written it, and to change it into a conversational language. When we're writing, we tend to write more formally, and that's fine. There are different types of language. If you're writing in Arabic, of course, you'll understand far better than me the different types of colloquial versus classical Arabic and the subtle nuances there. You have to use your judgment to figure out what's appropriate in which setting. But I tell you, there's two people in this emirate, Abu Dhabi, who are brilliant at this. And they've learned it over the past few years. And one is His Highness Sheikh Saif bin Zayed, the Interior Minister, and another is His Highness Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed, who's the Foreign Minister. When they give talks now, they're very conversational. They don't stand at a lectern like this, reading boring speeches. They walk about the stage. Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed, I saw him at a speech a while ago, he's telling stories about Sheikh Zayed and his grandfather and grandmother and being in Alain and in the Oasis. Very casual stories about, you know, oh, I was with my dad. Your dad's Sheikh Zayed. But he's doing that because he knows that that conversational style is much more engaging than being formal and talking at an audience. It really does work. Number three, the third tip I'm going to share with you is this. Most panel discussions are awful. Have any of you sat through any panel discussions before, either here or at school? Panel discussion is, you'll have like four seats here, and you'll have one guy, probably a journalist like me, asking questions, and three or four people all answering. And it's meant to be a discussion, but they tend to be really, really boring. There's a great public speaker called Scott Kirzner. He describes a panel discussion, Scott Birken. He describes a panel discussion. That is when four people get on stage and each one in turn bores the audience to death. That's his definition of a panel discussion. Another great public speaker called Scott Kirzner says, the bar is so low at panel discussions, particularly in the United States, but also globally. So the bar is so low that if you can offer a fleeting moment of entertainment, you will be hailed as a rock star by the organizers. And he says, if you can offer two things, some genuine insight and a little bit of controversy, they will erect a statue of you in the car park outside the convention center. That's how bad panel discussions are. Now, I'm not going to give you all the details on how to fix that, but what I will do is this, share some very quick hacks and quick tips. What you need to do, you need to have a bold opinion and something to say. So if you're in a panel discussion about shark fishing, you need to have an opinion on shark fishing. You have to say either not just shark fishing, it has to be, we should do more shark fishing because sharks are dangerous and they eat children in the sea. Or you should say, we should ban shark fishing. Sharks are an endangered species, we need to protect them. Either way is valid, but have an opinion and then back it up with facts, with stories and statistics. That's what you've got to do. And someone who did this brilliantly, I'm going to show you a couple of clips now, is Her Excellency Sheikh Abdur bin Sultan Al Qasimi, who's a businesswoman in Sharjah and also a member of the Sharjah ruling family. This is her speaking on a panel discussion in Jordan a while ago about youth unemployment, basically about you guys, about the fact that there aren't enough jobs in the Arab world and education isn't strong enough. It's a subject she feels very, very passionately about. And I'm going to play you three short clips of Sheikh Abdur speaking. And it's an absolute masterclass. Not because, and this is important, because I think she's a particularly brilliant speaker. She's okay. She's learned to be good. She's very competent. I know her. She wouldn't claim to be the world's greatest public speaker and is a little bit almost embarrassed that I put her in the book. But because she has learned her craft and learned to be a very good speaker. This is Sheikh Abdur.
So the first story is of this young Jordanian woman. Her name is Noor Al-Hassan, and she set up a company called Tarjama, which translates documents from Arabic to English. And the interesting thing is that she employs a lot of people who work from home, mainly women, and mainly in Saudi Arabia. The second story that I want to share with you is of Khalid Al-Khidir, who I think is here today. He's a Saudi entrepreneur, and he's set up Glowwork, which is an amazing initiative that provides employment for Saudi women. And thirdly, I want to talk about Najla Al-Mudfa, who's here as well today. She set up her company, Khayarat, which is a platform that helps young Emiratis get into the private sector.
So what she's done there, she's on a panel discussion, she's given three stories. She's told stories. In less than a minute, she's told three stories. We're at a book fair here. Those stories have got a story arc. There's a central character, there's a problem, and they solve that problem by setting up a company. Three stories in less than a minute. That is really, really good. The next thing she does is she makes a point. Because the premise of the panel discussion was that there are big problems in the Arab world. There's not enough jobs, there's a young population, and it's a really difficult time. She took the opposite view. She said, no, there's lots of things to be hopeful about in the Arab world. And this is her having a bold point of view.
So these are just three stories of what's happening in our part of the world. And it just illustrates that actually it's not all doom and gloom for the Arab millennials. There are actually good things happening. And we need to talk about these stories and share them.
It's not all doom and gloom for Arab millennials. The key to having a bold point of view is that someone could disagree with it. That is the litmus test. She says, It's not all the doom and gloom for Arab millennials. Could you disagree with that? You could. You could say it is all doom and gloom for Arab millennials. She's got off the fence and she's had a point of view. And crucially, she's backing it up. We saw stories beforehand, and then she uses statistics.
And I want to back it up with some statistics as well. In the UAE, I think SMEs contribute to about 94%. About 94% of the companies in UAE are SMEs, and they contribute to 60% of our GDP. 30% of them are run by women.
There you have statistics to back it up. This guy, who's even older than me, even older than Paul, is Aristotle. He was alive 2,500 years ago. He wrote the first ever public speaking manual. It's called On Rhetoric. He's a Greek philosopher. And essentially, all of the tips that I'm giving you, or anyone else will give you, Carmine Gallo, brilliant public speaking coach, was here a couple of days ago. They're basically based on what he said. He laid out his three artistic proofs, he called them. Ethos, logos, pathos. Ethos is credibility of the speaker. Shaker Bedore is credible because she's a senior businesswoman. Pathos is emotional content, appealing to the heart. Telling stories is a great way to appeal to the heart. But then logos, logical argument, appeal to the brain, and she does that with statistics. So these are the kind of things you should do. If you're on a panel or a discussion or a debate, you need a bold point of view and back it up with evidence. Hard evidence like statistics, softer evidence like anecdotes and stories. And you can do it in about an hour. It doesn't take that long. If you've got a checklist to go through and the book's full of checklists, you can do this in about an hour and you'll be good to go. Right, two tips left to go that I'm going to share with you today. Use the classic problem solution structure to persuade an audience. Structure is one of the most important things about a presentation. The temptation when we've got to give a presentation is you just start writing, or you open PowerPoint and you just start doing a kind of information dump. And I've done it. The better thing to do is to plan your presentation. Richard Heller, who's an author who writes about public speaking, says no architect would build a house without a plan first, without a detailed plan. And no one should create a presentation without a detailed plan. You don't have to invent the plan. There are lots of templates and checklists out there. Many of them are in the book. One of them that you should remember if you have to give a presentation. Have you got your phones with you, or do you not have phones? If you have a phone, type in the Decker Grid. D-E-C-K-E-R. If not, you can write it down. It's the one page, it's 20 boxes, it's the greatest presentation template in history. I'm not going to go through that now. I'm going to go through the most basic presentation structure there is. If you want to win an argument or a debate at school, and it's called the problem solution. Have we seen headache adverts on television? Adverts, for Panadol or something like it. And they all start, and someone's got a headache, and it's, oh, my head's hurting. And there's normally dark clouds, and there's screechy, screechy, screechy music. And then by the end of the 30-second advert, the sky is blue, and there are birds singing, and the music is la, 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 la. And the person's not like this. The person is walking happily, all because in 30 seconds they've popped a Panadol. That's the problem-solution structure, and it was invented by American advertising executives in the 1950s, and it is brilliant. And if you look at particularly political speeches, the problem-solution structure is everywhere. It's dead simple. I'm going to give you a couple of examples now. One is from this guy, Elon Musk, the guy who founded Tesla Motor Cars. This is him launching a product. He's into solar energy, and one of the products he launched a couple of years ago was a battery to have in your home so you could have solar panels on your roof and the battery would get charged during the day so that you could use solar power at night. And that's one of the big problems with solar power. You can't do it at night for obvious reasons. So he said, if you've got a really big battery in your home, you could have solar power at night. So this was him launching the Powerwall battery and spot the problem solution structure. And he even uses those words.
Now, the issue with existing batteries is that they suck, okay? They're really horrible. They look like that. So we have to come up with a solution. That's the missing piece. That's the thing that's needed to have a proper transition to a sustainable energy world. So the missing piece is what we're going to show you tonight.
Dead simple. Sets up a problem, presents his new product as the solution. It's really powerful, really effective. He's an American Silicon Valley billionaire, but the good news is you don't have to be a Silicon Valley billionaire to use this structure. You can be an Arab billionaire and use it, like Fadi Gandour. He's the man who founded Aramex, the courier logistics company in Jordan. He's Jordanian, but he's based here in the UAE now. He was one of the early investors in Careem, the ride-hailing company, which was just sold for $3 billion. He's a very, very savvy, successful businessman. But this is not him using the problem-solution structure to sell his new product. This is him using it to promote his not-for-profit organization in Amman, in Jordan, his home country. And he's doing a lot of good work to try and improve conditions for people on very low incomes. This is his TED talk from a couple of years ago in Palestine, talking about a problem in Amman, litter on the streets, and how to solve that problem.
Hanan al-Maghrabi, a young Jordanian lady living in Jabal al-Nadif, a marginalized community at the heart of Amman, says the problem of dirty streets and garbage in the streets in the community is a simple mathematical problem. What we should have, she says, is for every 250 people, you need one can, and then you will solve the problem of clean streets in Jabal al-Nadif.
And that's the great thing about problem solution. You can apply it to anything. If you want to win an election for your school council, problem solution. You got a new product, you want to sell it and become rich, problem solution. You want to save the world with your charitable philanthropic organization, problem solution. It just works. And it's dead quick, 30 minutes. Dead quick to produce a presentation like this. There are plenty of templates out there. Some of them are in my book. But if you just Google these things, I promise you, lots of great advice will come up. You don't have to buy a book. Much of it is out there free. Right, number one, the last one, kind of, I'm going to share with you today, is, and it's critical when you're producing presentations, remove the chart junk. Now, to be fair, this is more of a problem in corporate presentations than in the kind of presentations that you will present. But if you learn this habit early, it will serve you very, very well throughout college, university, and your career. Here's the thing. Edward Tufte is an American academic, and he came up with the phrase chart junk about 20 years ago to describe the clutter that you see in slides, in PowerPoint slides, that makes it really, really hard to read them. For example, if you look at the top here, the top is a chart about the oil price, something we watch very closely here in Abu Dhabi. And that's full of chart junk. It's a three-dimensional. There's lots of different charts going on. That's completely unnecessary. That 3D is nonsense. This, you don't need that there at all. It's just very confusing. Edward Tufte says we should use something like this. Clean and simple. All the chart junk is removed. And he said, think about ink as being the most valuable thing in the world. And whenever you do anything in PowerPoint, imagine you've got to pay for the ink, the virtual ink on the screen. And that will force you to, what he says, remove all non-data ink, everything that's not important, and therefore you'll get rid of the chart junk. Now, he was passionate about this 20 years ago, but he really became passionate about it in 2003 when this happened. The Space Shuttle Columbia crashed when it was re-entering the Earth's atmosphere, and all seven astronauts died. And the reason that he was passionate about this is that as a PowerPoint expert, he was brought in as part of the investigation to find out why the space shuttle crashed. And you're probably thinking, what on earth has presentation and PowerPoint got to do with the space shuttle crashing? Well, quite a lot, it turns out, because The shuttle crashed on February the 2nd, 2003, when it was re-entering the Earth's atmosphere, but the problem that caused the crash happened 2 weeks earlier when it was taking off. It was here. A little bit of the foam cladding on the space shuttle broke off, and that foam cladding was there to protect the shuttle on re-entry when it's very, very hot, re-entering the Earth's atmosphere. So the scientists at NASA knew this was a problem because they could see it. It happened within a minute of takeoff. And therefore, they had two questions to ask. One was, if this is a problem, can we rescue these astronauts, or are they just doomed to die? Well, they could have rescued them. There was another space shuttle. The Atlantis was ready for takeoff. They could have sent it up. They could have done a moonwalk. The astronauts could have got in Atlantis and come back to Earth safely. But they didn't send Atlantis. And this is the key point. Why didn't they send the space shuttle Atlantis to rescue these astronauts? Well, the reason they didn't is that the decision makers at NASA, the bosses, were given a presentation about this by the scientists, the junior scientists. And that's often the way. Junior people give presentations to more senior people, and senior people make a decision based on that. And this is the slide the scientists used to explain the danger facing the astronauts. Any scientists in the room? Anyone doing physics? Maybe you could spot the danger. I couldn't. It's there. Bottom two lines of a 20-line PowerPoint slide. That's the rocket science that says these guys are in serious, serious trouble. But the bosses, the decision makers, missed it because it was buried at the bottom of the slide. It should have been right at the top. Danger, astronauts could die, in flashing red letters. Then the bosses would have noticed it. Then they would have sent the space shuttle Atlantis. But they didn't because it was buried, because this slide is full of chart junk. You should never have slides like this. There's a guy called Seth Godin, who I quote in the book, who's a communication guru. He says there is a rule with PowerPoint, an unbreakable rule. And the rule is this: no more than 6 words per slide ever. Never more than 6 words per slide. Here, you've got a short essay. And it's full of chart junk. So ever since then, because these 7 astronauts died because of this, Edward Tufte has been fighting a war on chart junk. Things like this, he hates. Never produce slides like this. It's impossible. No more than 6 words per slide ever. Never do this. Never do that. That's 4 slides. Slides are free in PowerPoint. Break it up, make that 4 slides. And then this, the one I'm about to show you, has been voted several times the worst PowerPoint slide in the history of PowerPoint. Do you want to see it? This is it. Whoa! Kind of makes your brain hurt, doesn't it? This was produced by a consultancy to try and explain the American military offensive in Afghanistan. This is the kind of chart we should have. Sometimes we need to use charts in our slides. That's fine. Don't use too many of them, because they do make people's brain hurt. But you need a bit of data sometimes, you know, that logos. You sometimes need a bit of data, but if you're going to use slides, make them simple. Or better still, use a picture, because there's something in presentation science called the picture superiority effect. It's a well-known psychological phenomenon. People understand pictures much better than they do text, and there's a whole bunch of psychological evidence to show that that's true. Use more pictures in your slides. About 10 minutes or so for each slide, I reckon, to go through it, remove the chart junk, and maybe even replace it with a picture. So with that, we'll pause for a second. And what I'm going to do, has someone got a watch on or a phone? Can I grab the time? Can you tell me what time it is? 12:35. Okay, we've got about 15 minutes left then. So what I want to do in the next 15 minutes or so is to try and put some of these things into action. Okay? Take some of these ideas and put them into action. And also to drive home to you just how important it is to learn the skills of public speaking. Not by buying my book, necessarily, but by learning. There's loads of stuff out there online. Your teachers will help you. Lots of people can help you. It's a skill that you need to have. We're going to hear now from a guy called Warren Buffett, who's the world's richest investor. Depending on which list you read, he's the world's richest man. And he says the best investment he ever made wasn't buying stocks and shares. although he's bought a lot. It was investing in a public speaking course when he was at college because he was terrified of standing up giving speeches. But he knew if he wanted to grow his career and his company, he would have to learn to be good at public speaking. So he went on a course. And this is him speaking a few years ago to students, a little bit older than you, but students, explaining in financial terms just how valuable it is to learn the skill of public speaking.
Right now, I would pay $100,000 for 10% of the future earnings of any of you. So anybody wants to see me after this is over. Now, if that's true, you're a $1 million asset right now, right? If 10% of you is worth $100,000, you could improve about many of you, and I certainly could have when I got out. Just in terms of learning communication skills, you know, it's not something that's taught. I actually went to a Dale Carnegie course later on in terms of public speaking. But if you improve your value 50% by having better communication skills, that's, you know, it's another $500,000, you know, in terms of capital value. See me after the class and I'll pay you, you know, 150.
So there you go, 50% pay rise. What kind of careers are we looking at doing? Who's got a career in mind that they'd like to share with me? Any thoughts? Can I see a hand if you've got a career in mind? Yes, please. What's your career? Oh, we got a microphone there. Thank you.
A businessman.
Businessman? Sorry?
A businessman.
Businessman. Okay. And what else? Any others? Yes, please. Yes. The microphone's coming.
Economist.
Economist. Nice one. I like it. Basically, whatever you do, you'll earn 50% more at least if you're good at public speaking. And economics is an interesting one. I trained as an economist. I've worked as an economist. The ones who can tell a story really well earn the big bucks. And there's a few chapters in my book on it. There's a guy called Stephen King, not the horror writer, but he's chief economist at a bank called HSBC. He's a great showman. He uses colloquial language. He tells stories, and his charts are simple. He's really good. He earns a fortune as an economist. The guys who just sit at the back of the room crunching numbers all day, they're not the economists who earn the big bucks. Learn public speaking skills, whatever your career, it will stand you in good stead, I promise you. But even if it's not monetary, even if you're not a money-grabbing capitalist and you actually want to do some good in the world for other people, I can't relate to that myself, but I believe there are people for whom that is a calling in life, this will help you. Whatever your cause, public speaking will help you. Now, the exercise we're going to do is how to create one and only one killer message for your presentation. Because whatever you're presenting on, you need one strong message to build it around. It's the first lesson in my book, and it's the most important one. One message. I go to about 50 conferences a year as a speaker, sometimes I'm the MC, introducing people like Paul. I see about 500 presentations a year. I present a radio show in the morning. I interview 5 people on average each day. That's 1,000 interviews I do a year. The biggest flaw, bar none, in all of this public speaking is that people haven't got one clear message. They've got a vague idea what they want to talk about. Real estate in Abu Dhabi, restaurants in Sharjah, whatever it may be, but they don't have one clear, punchy message. I'm going to show you how we can do that, and I'm going to give you some tips for doing it. But first of all, what you've got to understand is this isn't easy, because people have very, 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 very short attention spans. So you've got to hit them between the eyes with your message from the outset. I'm going to show you how to do that, but first of all, I'm going to convince you that you need to. For example, public speaking has become much harder over the past 50 years because of what I call the 3 T's, television, Twitter, and TED. Twitter, 140 characters, TED Talks, only 18 minutes or 9 minutes, and television, soundbites are shrinking. For example, in 1968, the average TV soundbite was 43 seconds. That's how much, if you were being interviewed on television, that's how much time they'd give you. Went down to 9 seconds. How long do you think the average TV soundbite is now? Well, I'm going to show you. It's not very long. Yeah.
0.1.
You're not far off.
It's a very small element in my life, Megyn Kelly. I don't care about Megyn Kelly. I'm not a big fan of hers at all. I don't care.
When you meet her, you realize she's not very tough and she's not very sharp.
She's a third-rate reporter. Whoever even heard of her before the last debate?
It's a couple of seconds. You've got to be quick to be heard. You've got to hit people between the eyes and be punchy. So, how do you do that? He was the master of it, Steve Jobs. Any Apple fans here? Yeah, quite a few actually, yeah. Steve Jobs was brilliant at technology, but his real skill was showmanship and selling these products and convincing us that we needed the iMac, the iPhone, the iPad, whatever it may be. When he launched the iPhone, 12 years ago now, 2-hour presentation on the stage in San Francisco, but it was all built around one snappy phrase: today Apple reinvents the phone. And I'm going to show you how to create your one snappy phrase for whatever it is you're presenting in a second. But this was the phrase that he used on stage. It was the headline of the press release that he had that day. And this is the hair stand up on the back of your neck moment, at least for me, when he introduced the first ever iPhone.
So, three things: a widescreen iPod with touch controls, a revolutionary mobile phone, and a breakthrough internet communications device. An iPod, a phone, and an internet communicator. An iPod, a phone. Are you getting it? These are not three separate devices. This is one device. And we are calling it iPhone. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone.
One punchy headline. And the media use it all the time, and it's still used today. And it's from the book by Carmine Gallo, who was here a couple of days ago, The Presentations of Secrets of Steve Jobs, one of the classic tips from that. And it's one of the exercises in my book as well. So what I'm going to leave you with is a rapid-fire, surefire way to produce one punchy message for your next presentation. If you get that, you're sorted. My first day at journalism school in 1990, a long time ago. If you get the first paragraph right, the rest of the story writes itself. If you get this message right, the rest of the presentation is built around that and writes itself. And this is how you do it. Okay, the reason they gave you those pads and paper was actually not to throw paper balls at me. It was to write down some notes. Only one thing I'm going to ask you to write down, and then I'm going to let you go, okay? Maybe even answer some questions if you want. But write this down, because it's a surefire technique. To get one message, you need to do three things. And this is a tip by a brilliant woman called Nancy Duarte. Her book, Slideology, is an absolute classic. Nancy Duarte, she's brilliant. Duarte, if you want to follow her on Twitter, you will learn an awful lot. Anyway, the first thing you need is a point of view. The second thing you need is to state very clearly what's at stake for the audience if they do or do not do as you ask them. And the third thing you need to do is write it all down as one and only one short sentence. That is the 3-step rule for creating one punchy message. And if you want to know how to do it, Google Nancy Duarte, one punchy message, and it's there. It's on her blog. She's giving it away free. So let's do this. Who's got a presentation coming up that they'd like some help with in refining their one punchy message, or a presentation that they might want to give? Anyone want to share an idea with us? Yes? Awesome. Can I come down here, or am I going to create all kinds of feedback? Yeah, I can come. Yeah, awesome. Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to ask both of you now. So, have you got a presentation coming up? Take the microphone. Can you tell us, what is your presentation about?
The biggest breakthrough in history, the devices, technology.
The biggest breakthrough in history?
Yeah.
In terms of technology devices?
Yeah.
And why are you doing that presentation? Is that through school or something else?
Yeah, school.
With a microphone, hold it like an ice cream cone, like you're just about to eat it. That's the trick with these microphones. So who gave you this presentation to produce?
Our humanities teacher.
Has everybody got the same presentation? So you've got quite a broad idea there, okay? Yeah. It's the greatest breakthrough in history in terms of technological devices. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, great starting point. So we've got, thank you very much indeed. Thank you so much. So we've got our vague idea. Greatest breakthrough in history, technological devices. But we need our unique point of view on this, okay? That's a vague idea, and we all start with this. But what is your unique point of view on this? What do you think is the greatest breakthrough in terms of technological devices? Do you have a device in mind? You do. Okay, can you tell me what it is?
The 3D printer.
The 3D printer, okay. So the 3D printer is the greatest breakthrough in history in terms of a technological device. Is that correct? That's your point of view. Okay, brilliant. Round of applause, because we are a third of the way towards having our one killer message. We've gone from something vague, a vague idea, which is great breakthroughs in history, technologically, to having a unique point of view. And the acid test, the litmus test, for a bold point of view, a unique point of view, is could we disagree with it? Could we disagree with this? Yes, we could. And in fact, I'm going to disagree with you. I don't think the 3D printer is the biggest breakthrough. But that's not the point. You want people to be able to disagree with you. You're going to have to back it up with evidence throughout your presentation, but we've got a bold point of view. That is much better than most people have. Most people don't have a point of view. Okay, what's at stake? Okay, why does it matter? Why is it the greatest breakthrough in history? Again, if you can grab the microphone. You're going to really regret putting your hand up, aren't you, and sitting at the front. I'm sorry. It'll be over soon, I promise you.
Well, I think it's because everything can be created with it, and everyone can copy something with the 3D printer.
Okay. Great. That's why. Everyone can copy. Okay. So we've got a bold point of view. The 3D printer is the greatest breakthrough in history in terms of technological devices. And what's at stake is that everyone can copy something with it. Again, round of applause. Thank you very much indeed. And the only thing you've got left to do now is to write it all down as one sentence. My handwriting is too bad to do that. But we would say something like, the 3D printer is the greatest ever breakthrough in terms of technological devices because it allows everybody to copy anything. And there you go. And then you spend the rest of your presentation backing that up. Now you need a bit of pathos, emotional evidence to back that up, some pictures, some stories, some anecdotes to make people care. You need some evidence, some logos, find some evidence, some research papers, some numbers, some statistics to back it up to try and convince an audience. You might even want to use the problem-solution structure to use it. The problem is that building materials are very, very expensive and building things is very, very slow. The solution is the 3D printer. We can even 3D print buildings now. So you could use the problem-solution structure. There are so many weapons and tools at your disposal. But once you've got that one punchy message, you are off to the races, and I'm confident that you are going to give a cracking presentation at school. So good luck with that. Thank you very much indeed. And once again, congratulations. So that's kind of it from me. I set out, my kind of goal this morning was to convince you that you and you and you can transform your talks in minutes, quickly, using the hints and hacks and pro tips from great speakers. People like Elon Musk, people like Steve Jobs, like Jack Welch, like Tony Robbins, like Sheikh Badr al-Qassimi, like Fadi Gandour, like His Highness Sheikh Saif bin Zayed Al Nahyan. It's all out there. The evidence is there. All you have to do is use it. The greatest speech of the 20th century, that's the one just gone, is I Have a Dream by Martin Luther King. Has anyone seen that? It's an incredible speech. Again, Google it, it's on YouTube. I Have a Dream. just about 17 minutes long, and he gave it in the 1960s in Washington, D.C., and essentially it was he was a black preacher, and he was campaigning against the institutional racism that was prevalent in the United States at the time, and that speech essentially paved the way for the United States to do away with that legislation. I'm oversimplifying a very complex piece of history, but it's a brilliant speech. The point was, there are 134 rhetorical devices in that speech. I counted them for the book, 134. And do we know how many of those Martin Luther King invented? None of them. Not a single one. He stole the lot. Anaphora, epistrophe, antithesis, analogy, all of these techniques, they're all out there. They exist. They've existed for thousands of years. He just used them to powerful effect, one every 7 seconds or so. All these tools are out there. All I would encourage you to do, and this is one thing I leave you with, is use the tools that history has given you because they make your life so much simpler and quicker. Thank you very much. Now, I know many of you have got buses to catch, but if you've got any questions, I'm happy to take two or three of them. So who's got the first question? And you're off the hook. Thank you very much. If you could tell me your name and your school, and then the question, please.
My name is Salim from the Alpha International School. What if it's a practical presentation, nothing to do with data?
What if it's a practical presentation and nothing to do with?
Data.
Okay. A practical presentation, there's two or three types of presentation. One is to persuade. You want people to do something. Buy your product. Vote for you. Change their behavior by using less plastic bags, whatever it is. Sometimes the other type of presentation is an informational presentation. So effectively, you're just training someone. You're giving them information, how to change the wheel on a car, how to, or like your teachers do, you know, teaching them about an episode in the UAE's history, the moment that the UAE was founded. Even in a presentation like that, these tools are invaluable, particularly the bit about Aristotle, using both pathos, emotional content, and logos, logical content. Because if you have all you've got is anecdotes and stories, and it's funny and lots of nice, pretty pictures, people will think you lack substance, so they won't pay attention. If all you've got is logos, facts and figures and statistics and powerful arguments, you will bore them to death. So whatever you're doing, shake it up. I'll give you an example. I used to teach journalism. Because that's my background, journalism. I used to teach journalism at Middlesex University in Dubai. And there's a great technique from a guy called Dr. John Medina. He wrote a book called Brain Rules. And he's a neuroscientist, and he's a professor, and he teaches. And he says, essentially, people have attention spans of about 10 minutes. And every 10 minutes, you need to do something to shake them up or wake them up. So when I was teaching 6 or 7 years ago, what I used to do when I could see my students falling asleep after about 10 or 12 minutes, I'd play a music video like Gangnam Style was really popular at the time. He just put on Gangnam Style, and everyone wakes up, it's Gangnam Style, and everyone starts doing the, you know, you probably did it at birthday parties when you were younger. So people did that, and you shake them up, and it's just using a little bit of pathos, of emotion, to grab their attention. So any presentation you're doing, not all of these rules apply to every presentation, but some of them will apply to every presentation. You can go and get your bus. It's okay. I'm not taking a register. Thank you so much for being here. I'll take a couple more questions. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Emerson from Diaf International School. I want to know, what's your one biggest tip on public speaking?
Well, the big one would be one killer message. Have one and only one killer message and build your entire presentation around it. If we take a step back, the CrowdPlease 100 greatest public speaking tips of all time, none of them are mine. It's the Barack Obama tip, or it's the Saif bin Zayed tip, or it's the Nancy Duarte tip. So the number one, and the first one is have one killer message, as we just showed. If you get that, everything else will fall into place. If you don't have one killer message, none of the others will work. And I say in the book, I love all the 100 tips equally, like they were my children. But if we were heading towards a mountain in an aeroplane and I only had one parachute, which tip would I give the parachute to? I would give the parachute to Nancy Duarte's one killer message tip, because it is the one that will get things going for you. One last question. Thank you.
Richard, these are the students from our school. These are our top speakers who participated in debate, who usually participate in debate competitions. And I was so glad when this event was organized. And this is outstanding. Your session was great. It's not a question, it's a compliment.
Oh, thank you. Well, I'll take it. Thank you very much. I agree. Yes, I'm fantastic. And with that, we'll leave it. Thank you very much indeed for being here. I really appreciate it. I'm going to be around for a little while if you've got any more questions. But now I'll get off the stage. Can we cut my microphone? Because everyone's sick of hearing from me. Thank you.